In this video, we'd like to talk about ways to calculate energy that are involved in physical change. But before we dive into that, I'd like to just do a couple preliminary things. Talk about temperature. And temperature is the measure of molecular motion. It really is a measure of how fast molecules are moving. But according to the formula for figuring out kinetic energy, it's 1/2 mass times velocity squared. There's also a component of mass in there. And the way you could think about this is if we had a container that had both helium and argon particles in there, and the temperature was 34 degrees C, that 34 degrees C would measure the speed, basically, of helium, and it would also measure the speed of argon. And as you can see in this little demonstration, the argon, because it's larger, moves much slower, whereas the helium, which is smaller, less mass, it actually moves a little faster. But together, on average, they move at a measurement of 34 degrees Celsius. And the true measurement, if you would measure with Kelvin as opposed to Celsius, because that truly measures molecular motion. When Kelvin goes to zero, the motion is stopped. And temperature is not a measurement of the entire volume. It is a measure of points within there, or basically the average. The molecule we'll use to understand physical change is water. Covalently bound protons and the oxygen are reaching out and grabbing common electrons that it shares with hydrogen. So it's a tightly shared covalent bond. Oxygen pulls a little stronger than hydrogen, so those electrons in the bond literally shift over there. So you can see them actually move over. That makes oxygen partially negative, and it makes hydrogen partially positive. So let's explain physical change, and let's just start with ice at minus 10 degrees C. And ice is, once again, all these polar water molecules, and they align and are bound with intermolecular bonds. These are hydrogen bonds that connect the hydrogen bond acceptor is what we call the H plus, and then the hydrogen bond donator is the lone pair of electrons from the oxygen. So there's a weak intermolecular force between all these waters. So I'm going to draw these in here. And this is what makes ice. It's a unique organized structure. It has a lot of open space. All these strong hydrogen bonds form, and it's less dense than water. That's what the open space provides. And if you're talking about the temperature at minus 10, which is really 263 Kelvin, so it still has a lot of energy. If you're really talking about this energy, it's caused from vibration. So these molecules are sitting here literally held together by hydrogen bonds, but vibrating in place. And as you start heating it up, they'll just vibrate faster. Okay, once you finally get to melting, now all of a sudden something's different between just vibrating and you keep increasing the energy. At some point, the next amount of energy goes into breaking these intermolecular forces. Okay, not all of them, but some of them. And the energy involved isn't making it vibrate any faster. It's just basically breaking the bond, so there's no change in the motion. And that's called latent heat, which means it's hidden from the thermometer. When ice melts, you don't see a change in temperature. Or when any material melts, you won't see a change in temperature. Now you get to water, once again, still at zero. And basically, there are hydrogen bonds still holding it together. There's less. In ice, they say that there's about 4 hydrogen bonds per molecule. When you get to water, you're basically at 3, on average, about 3.4 hydrogen bonds per molecule. And the only difference between water at 0 degrees C and ice at 0 degrees C is these particular molecules have more of rotational motion. If you're wondering about the speed at which they're vibrating or rotating, it's exactly the same. And so now once you start heating up water, it's just going to start rotating faster and faster and faster, and that's hence the kinetic energy is going up, the temperature is going up. And H-bonding is still the predominant intermolecular force. So here these guys are rotating. So now when we finally get to the boiling point, what starts happening? Whatever intermolecular forces hold it together, those completely dissipate. You break those. So once again, it's a latent heat. You're basically breaking these bonds, and the energy involved does not translate to faster motion. And the next thing you know, you have steam at 100 degrees C. Well, if it's still at 100 degrees C, it's moving at the same rate. The only difference is water predominantly is spinning, steam is freely translating. The molecules have no connection. You're completely free from the intermolecular hydrogen bonds, and they're freely moving about. So this is now steam at boiling point. And then if you heat it up more, they move about faster, and that's basically what the gaseous state is, freely translating molecules. And as I point out here, they're far enough apart from each other that the intermolecular force can't reach across that span. Once again, that's according to Coulomb's law, the charge on this oxygen, the charge on that hydrogen, divided by the distance squared. Well, the distance squared is far enough that this, basically the energy attracting them is insignificant. So these are freely translating, moving about. So let's just talk about naming these state changes. So this transition from solid to liquid is called melting if you're going up in energy. And if you go down in energy, it's called freezing. And the energy to melt something is exactly equal to the energy to freeze something per mole of molecule that you're melting or freezing, if it's the same material. The transition from liquid to gas, if you're going up in energy, is called boiling. And if you go in reverse, it's called condensing. And then it's also possible to make full jumps. In other words, you start at solid, you jump one state, and you end up in the gas, as we saw in the phase diagrams on another YouTube video. That's called sublimation. And if you start off at the gaseous state and you make a jump down to the solid state, that's called deposition. So these are six terms that you should be familiar with. The point of this talk, though, is about doing actual energy calculations on this. The first phase transition uses this formula where Q means heat. Q represents heat, N is number of moles, and there's a constant. It's called the enthalpy of fusion, and that's the energy constant. That this calculates how much energy is involved in actually melting something, and it's actually the same amount of energy that's required to freeze something per mole of material. The next transition, if you look, it has the same setup. The only difference is the constant's different because the heat of fusion is different than what this is called, the heat of vaporization. And the heat of vaporization is the energy cost to go from the liquid to the gas state. It's the same formula you use for doing condensing. So the energy involved in making something heat up without changing state basically takes this form, Q equals mc delta T. Q is the energy involved. M is the mass, in this case, of the material that you're trying to heat up. C is a constant we're going to talk about farther called the specific heat. It's an intrinsic property of that material. And the delta T is how much temperature you're trying to change. And the difference here in heating a solid versus heating a liquid, formula looks exactly the same. The only difference is the specific heat is specific to a liquid. So in this case, we look up the specific heat of water. Or in here, we'd look up the specific heat of ice. And sure enough, the gas has the exact same form, mc delta T. The difference is the specific heat you would refer to for this formula is the specific heat of steam. A couple notes on the formulas. N is a common symbol for moles. So sometimes you see this formula listed as Q equals nc delta T. That means that when I look up my specific heat, I gotta look for specific heat and convert it to per moles. Sometimes you see it in mass. So just pay attention to the units. In this case, it'd be mc delta T. In that case, you want to use a specific heat that is in terms of joules per gram Celsius. And these are interconvertible. How many grams are in a mole of water? Basically, the conversion factor is 18. So mass is not the same as moles, but it can be converted. Well, just a reminder once again, C is state dependent. The point here is just basically make sure that when you look up C, pay attention to the units and pay attention to what the state is. All right, so here's some heat capacities, some different materials. I want you to have kind of a general feel about what heat capacity means. These are considered relatively low heat capacities, right, in this area, when they're below one. So here's a translation for what a low heat capacity means. If you add a lot of energy to it, it will have a very rapid change in temperature. So things like metals have low heat capacity. That's why we use metals in cookingware, because we want the energy that we pump into the cookingware to quickly translate to heating up whatever's on top of the metal pan. If you have a higher heat capacity, like above one, especially water actually has a hugely high heat capacity, then what that means is as you add temperature or energy to it, the temperature will change very slowly. So these are considered heat insulators, or they're also considered good heat storage materials. So what that means in reverse is that water, after it's absorbed a lot of energy and the temperature's heated up, it will slowly leak that energy back out, where things that have low heat capacities and you heat them up and you take the heat source off, then that heat will rapidly be released. So these are the kind of materials you might use, example, for a heat sink in your house. If you wanted to heat up water during the day, during the night it'll slowly leak it off. That's why a lot of coastal cities have a very constant temperature. So at this point I'm going to show you a little demonstration of heat capacity.
I would like to show you a demonstration of how high specific heat materials act. So what I have here is a plastic bag. It's filled with water, and water has a high specific heat. I'll get a little closer, we can see what's going on. I'm going to basically take the fire near to the plastic bag. And you'll see that basically, because of the high specific heat of water, it's able to absorb the heat from the burner. And just to once again prove the idea, let's take something that has like plastic and that has no water in there to protect it. And you can see that immediately it reacts to the heat. There you go. Little fire.
So let's talk about using the calculation of heat. This is the formula, MC delta T, or as we discussed earlier, it could be an NC delta T. When you're staying within the same state and you're just changing the temperature of something. So how much energy is required to heat 250 mils of water from 50 C to 85 C? First off, because we're using the M form, we got to have volume of water turned to mass. And luckily, water has a density of 1, so 250 mils of water is 250 grams of water, and that's unique to water, but it works for this. The temperature change is going from 50 to 85. So now this is a good point to show you something about temperature change. If you start at 50 and you end up at 85, that's 35 degrees C change. If you convert these both to Kelvin and you subtract 358.15 from 323.15, that once again is 35 degree change. So whenever you do temperature change, and it can be either Celsius or Kelvin, it'll be the same amount of degrees. So when you do delta T subtraction, it's okay to leave it in Celsius. 4.184 is the specific heat unit, and look how I stack this in here with joules per gram Kelvin times the mass, 250 g. Temperature change, 85 minus 50 is 35. And now you just cancel out all your units and you solve, and you basically get 3.66 times 10 to the fourth joules. That's your answer. That's how many joules of energy it would take to heat 250 mils of water from 50 C to 85 C. And the last step is this. You need to think about whether it's endothermic or exothermic. If you're heating something up, it took energy in. So traditionally, you put a positive sign on that. So conversely, how much energy is required to cool the same amount of water from 85 to 50? In other words, we're going to cool it the same amount that we heated it. The calculation's exactly the same. The difference is, because now you're cooling it, you've got to let the energy leave the water to cool it off. So the sign that you put on there, it's exothermic, is classically a negative sign. So anything that's exothermic is negative and endothermic is plus, and that's relative to the reaction. Okay, let's talk about doing the latent heat formula. That's where you basically take your constant times the N, in this case, which would be number of moles, or it could have been in mass. You just got to pay attention to what your fusion units are in, or your vaporization units. And just make sure you understand that in a handbook, usually FUS refers to fusion, which is melting or freezing. And when you look at the handbook and you see a VAP, that's vaporization, which refers to boiling or condensing. So here's an example of some different latent heat constants. So water, what does it take to basically melt water? And it is a little pressure dependent. At 0 C, for every mole of water, it takes 6 kilojoules to melt it or to freeze it. And the important thing too is that you, along with the heat of fusion, you also have the exact melting point, because that's the temperature it has to be when this energy kicks in the latent. Then if you raise it up to 100 C or 373.1 K, right, then it takes 40.7 kilojoules for every mole of water you're boiling. And take note of the other thing is that the heat of vaporization is always higher than the heat of fusion. And there's some hand-waving justification for that, and that is basically in this particular case, you're going from some intermolecular attraction to none at all. And when you melt things, you still retain some intermolecular attraction. In other words, things in the solid state have a lot more intermolecular attraction, what locks them into their crystal. But then as you melt it, you basically break some of those bonds of attraction, but you don't break all of them. That's why they remain in the liquid state and stay close together. So now we're going to do a calculation that shows you how to use both of these formulas. And what we're going to do is take aluminum at room temperature, about 297K, 20 degrees Celsius, and we're going to heat it up to its melting point, which we see on here is about 933K. And then we're going to actually melt it. So it's going to take MC delta T to heat it up. And then it's going to take the heat of fusion times the number of moles to figure out how much energy it actually takes, the latent heat. Starting with MC delta T, we have 14.5 kilograms of aluminum. If you convert that, that's 14,500 grams. You take it times the specific heat, which is 0.9. And look how I stack this constant. Grams and Kelvin are on the bottom. And then we do the temperature change, which is 933K minus 297K. And once you work this all out, you basically get 8,300 kilojoules. Now, when you go to do the latent heat that's involved in melting the aluminum, we've got it to the right temperature now. That's what that energy's for. So I gotta take 14.5 kilograms, turn it to grams, and then look on the periodic table and see that there's 26.98 grams of aluminum in every mole. So that calculation leaves you at 537 moles. 537 moles times the constant for fusion, which is 10.9 kilojoules per mole. That gives me 5.86 times 10 to the third kilojoules. And that also is positive. This, by the way, is also positive. All this is heating up, energy in. It's endothermic to get this to happen. You add these two energies together, and you end up with 14,160 kilojoules, or 14.2 megajoules is a metric conversion. And just one other comment is, what conditions do you need to avoid? Well, if you started heating aluminum in the room, it would react with oxygen and make aluminum oxide. So you'd have to put this under some sort of inert atmosphere in order for this reaction to really happen. So this basically is how you calculate the energy for physical change. I hope this helps you understand that concept.